This is Jack Foley with Cover to Cover. Today's show is devoted to readings by the Welsh poet Dylan Thomas. You'll hear Thomas read his story, A Child's Christmas in Wales, and that will be followed by two poems, Fern Hill and Do Not Go Gentle Into That Good Night.
One Christmas was so much like the other in those years around the Seatown corner now. Out of all sound except the distant speaking of the voices I sometimes hear a moment before sleep. That I can never remember whether it snowed for 6 days and six nights when I was 12, or whether it snowed for 12 days and 12 nights when I was 6. All the Christmases rolled down towards the two-tongued sea like a cold and headlong moon bundling down the sky that was our street. And they stop at the rim of the ice-edged, fish-freezing waves, and I plunge my hands in the snow and bring out whatever I can find. In goes my hand into that wool-white, bell-tongued ball of holidays resting at the rim of the carol-singing sea. And out come Mrs. Prothero and the firemen. It was on the afternoon of the day of Christmas Eve, and I was in Mrs. Prothero's garden, waiting for cats with her son, Jim. It was snowing. It was always snowing at Christmas. December, in my memory, is white as Lapland, although there were no reindeers. But there were cats. Patient, cold, and callous, our hands wrapped in socks, we waited to snowball the cats. Sleek and long as jaguars and horrible whiskered, spitting and snarling, they would slide and sidle over the white back garden walls, and the lynx-eyed hunters, Jim and I, fur-capped and moccasined trappers from Hudson Bay off Mumbles Road, would hurl our deadly snowballs at the green of their eyes. The wise cats never appeared. We were so still, Eskimo-footed Arctic marksmen in the muffling silence of the eternal snows, eternal ever since Wednesday, that we never heard Mrs. Prothero's first cry from her igloo at the bottom of the garden. Or if we heard it at all, it was to us like the far-off challenge of our enemy and prey, the neighbor's polar cat. But soon the voice grew louder. Fire, cried Mrs. Prothero. And she beat the dinner gong. And we ran down the garden with the snowballs in our arms towards the house, and smoke indeed was pouring out of the dining room, and the gong was bombolating, and Mrs. Prothero was announcing ruin like a town crier in Pompeii. This was better than all the cats in Wales standing on the wall in a row. We bounded into the house laden with snowballs and stopped at the open door of the smoke-filled room. Something was burning, all right. Perhaps it was Mr. Prothero, who always slept there after midday dinner with a newspaper over his face. But he was standing in the middle of the room saying, a fine Christmas, and smacking at the smoke with a slipper. Call the fire brigade, cried Mrs. Prothero as she beat the gong. They won't be here, said Mr. Prothero. It's Christmas. There was no fire to be seen, only clouds of smoke, and Mr. Prothero standing in the middle of them, waving his slipper as though he were conducting. Do something, he said. And we threw all our snowballs into the smoke. I think we missed Mr. Prothero, and ran out of the house to the telephone box. Let's call the police as well, Jim said, and the ambulance, and Ernie Jenkins, he likes fires. But we only called the fire brigade. And soon the fire engine came, and three tall men in helmets brought a hose into the house, and Mr. Prothero got out just in time before they turned it on. Nobody could have had a noisier Christmas Eve. And when the fireman turned off the hose and was standing in the wet, smoky room, Jim's aunt, Miss Prothero, came downstairs and peered in at them. Jim and I waited very quietly to hear what she would say to them. She said the right thing, always. She looked at the three tall firemen in their shining helmets, standing among the smoke and cinders and dissolving snowballs, and she said, would you like anything to read? Years and years ago, when I was a boy, when there were wolves in Wales, and birds the color of red flannel petticoats whisked past the harp-shaped hills, when we sang and wallowed all night and day in caves that smelt like Sunday afternoons in damp front farmhouse parlors, and we chased with the jawbones of deacons the English and the bears. Before the motor car, before the wheel, before the Duchess-faced horse, when we rode the daft and happy hills bareback, it snowed and it snowed. But here a small boy says, it snowed last year too. I made a snowman and my brother knocked it down, and I knocked my brother down, and then we had tea. But that was not the same snow, I say. Our snow was not only shaken from whitewash buckets down the sky. It came shawling out of the ground and swam and drifted out of the arms and hands and bodies of the trees. Snow grew overnight on the roofs of the houses like a pure and grandfather moss. Minutely ivied the walls and settled on the postman opening the gate like a dumb, numb thunderstorm of white, torn Christmas cards. Were there postmen then, too? With sprinkling eyes and wind-cherried noses on spread, frozen feet, they crunched up to the doors and mittened on them manfully. But all that the children could hear was a ringing of bells. You mean that the postman went rat-a-tat-tat and the doors rang? I mean that the bells that the children could hear were inside them. I only hear thunder sometimes, never bells. There were church bells, too. Inside them? No, in the bat-black, snow-white belfries tugged by bishops and storks. And they rang their tidings over the bandaged town, over the frozen foam of the powder and ice cream hills, over the crackling sea. It seemed that all the churches boomed for joy under my window, and the weathercocks crew for Christmas on our fence. Get back to the postman. They were just ordinary postmen, fond of walking and dogs and Christmas and the snow. They knocked on the doors with blue knuckles. Ours has got a black knocker. And then they stood on the white welcome mat in the little drifted porches and huffed and puffed, making ghosts with their breath, and jogged from foot to foot like small boys wanting to go out. And then the presents. And then the presents after the Christmas box. And the cold postman with a rose on his button nose tingled down the tea tray slithered run of the chilly, glinting hill. He went in his ice-boned boots like a man on fishmonger's slabs. He wagged his bag like a frozen camel's hump, dizzily turned the corner on one foot, and by God, he was gone. Get back to the present. There were the useful presents, engulfing mufflers of the old coach days and mittens made for giant sloths, zebra scarves of a substance like silky gum that could be tug-of-war down to the galoshes, blinding tam-o'-shanters like patchwork tea cozies and bunny-suited busbies and balaclavas for victims of head-shrinking tripes. From aunts who always wore wool next to the skin, there were moustached and rasping vests that made you wonder why the aunts had any skin left at all. And once I had a little crocheted nose bag from an aunt now, alas, no longer whinnying with us. And pictureless books in which small boys, though warned with quotations not to, would skate on Farmer Giles's pond and did and drowned. And books that told me everything about the wasp, except why. Go on to the useless presents. Bags of moist and many-colored jelly babies, and a folded flag and a false nose and a tram conductor's cap and a machine that punched tickets and rang a bell. Never a catapult. Once, by a mistake that no one could explain, a little hatchet. And a celluloid duck that made, when you pressed it, a most unduck-like sound. A mewing moo that an ambitious cat might make who wished to be a cow. and a painting book in which I could make the grass, the trees, the sea, and the animals any color I please. And still the dazzling sky-blue sheep are grazing in the red field under the rainbow-billed and pea-green birds. Hard-boiled, toffee, fudge, and all sorts, crunches, cracknel, humbugs, glaciers, marzipan, and butter Welsh for the Welsh. And troops of bright tin soldiers who, if they could not fight, could always run. And snakes and families and happy ladders and easy hobby games for little engineers, complete with instructions. Oh, easy for Leonardo. And a whistle to make the dogs bark, to wake up the old man next door, to make him beat on the wall with his stick, to shake our picture off the wall. And a packet of cigarettes. You put one in your mouth and you stood at the corner of the street and you waited for hours in vain for an old lady to scold you for smoking a cigarette, and then with a smirk you ate it. And then it was breakfast under the balloons. Were there uncles like in our house? There are always uncles at Christmas, the same uncles. And on Christmas mornings with dog-disturbing whistle and sugar fags, I would scour the swathed town for the news of the little world and find always a dead bird by the post office or the white deserted swings. Perhaps a robin, all but one of his fires out. Men and women wading, scooping back from chapel with taproom noses and wind-busked cheeks, all albinos, huddled their stiff black jarring feathers against the irreligious snow. Mistletoe hung from the gas brackets in all the front parlors. There was sherry and walnuts and bottled beer and crackers by the dessert spoons. And cats in their furabouts watched the fires. And the high-heaped fire spat, all ready for the chestnuts and the mulling pokers. Some few large men sat in the front parlors without their collars, uncles almost certainly, trying their new cigars, holding them out judiciously at arm's length, returning them to their mouths, coughing, then holding them out again as though waiting for the explosion. And some few small aunts, not wanted in the kitchen, nor anywhere else for that matter, sat on the very edges of their chairs, poised and brittle, afraid to break like faded cups and saucers. Not many those mornings trod the piling streets. An old man, always fawn-bowlered, yellow-gloved, and at this time of year with spats of snow, would take his constitutional to the white bowling green and back as he would take it wet or fire or on Christmas Day or Doomsday. Sometimes two hale young men with big pipes blazing, no overcoats and wind-blown scarves, would trudge unspeaking down to the forlorn sea to work up an appetite to blow away the fumes, who knows, to walk into the waves until nothing of them was left but the two curling smoke clouds of their inextinguishable briars. Then I would be slap-dashing home, the gravy smell of the dinners of others, the bird smell, the brandy, the pudding and mince coiling up to my nostrils, when out of a snow-clogged side lane would come a boy, the spit of myself, with a pink-tipped cigarette and the violet past of a black eye, cocky as a bullfinch, leering all to himself. I hated him on sight and sound, and would be about to put my dog whistle to my lips and blow him off the face of Christmas, when suddenly he, with a violet wink, put his whistle to his lips and blew so stridently, so high, so exquisitely loud, that gobbling faces, their cheek bulged with goose, would press against their tinseled windows the whole length of the white echoing street. For dinner we had turkey and blazing pudding, and after dinner the uncles sat in front of the fire, loosened all buttons, put their large, moist hands over their watch chains, groaned a little, and slept. Mothers, aunts, and sisters scuttled to and fro bearing tureens. Aunt Bessie, who had already been frightened twice by a clockwork mouse, whimpered at the sideboard and had some elderberry wine. The dog was sick. Auntie Dursey had to have 3 aspirins, but Auntie Hannah, who liked port, stood in the middle of the snowbound backyard, singing like a big-bosomed thrush. I would blow up balloons to see how big they would blow up to, and then when they burst, which they all did, the uncles jumped and rumbled. In the rich and heavy afternoon, the uncles breathing like dolphins and the snow descending, I would sit among festoons and Chinese lanterns and nibble dates and try to make a model man-o-war following the instructions for little engineers and produce what might be mistaken for a sea-going tramcar. Or I would go out, my bright new boots squeaking into the white world onto the seaward hill, to call on Jim and Dan and Jack, and to pad through the still streets, leaving huge, deep footprints on the hidden pavements. I bet people will think they've been hippos. What did you do if I saw a hippo coming down our street? I'd go like this, bang! I'd throw him over the railings and roll him down the hill, and then I'd tickle him under the ear and he'd wag his tail. What would you do if you saw 2 hippos? Iron-flanked and bellowing he-hippos clanked and battered through the scudding snow towards us as we passed Mr. Daniel's house. Let's post Mr. Daniel a snowball through his letterbox. Let's write things in the snow. Let's write, Mr. Daniel looks like a spaniel all over his lawn. While we walked on the white shore, can the fishes see it snowing? The silent, one-clouded heavens drifted onto the sea. Now we were snow-blind travelers lost on the North Hills, and vast, dew-lapped dogs with flasks around their necks ambled and shambled up to us, baying Excelsior. We returned home through the poor streets, where only a few children fumbled with bare red fingers in the wheel-rutted snow and cat-called after us, their voices fading away as we trudged uphill into the cries of the dock birds and the hooting of ships out in the whirling bay. And then at tea, the recovered uncles would be jolly, and the ice cake loomed in the center of the table like a marble grave. Auntie Hannah laced her tea with rum because it was only once a year. Bring out the tall tales now that we told by the fire as the gaslight bubbled like a diver. Ghosts wooed like owls in the long nights when I dared not look over my shoulder. Animals lurked in the cubbyhole under the stairs where the gas meter ticked. And I remember that we went singing carols once when there wasn't the shaving of a moon to light the flying streets. At the end of a long road was a drive that led to a large house, and we stumbled up the darkness of the drive that night, each one of us afraid, each one holding a stone in his hand, in case, and all of us too brave to say a word. The wind through the trees made noises as of old and unpleasant and maybe web-footed men wheezing in caves. We reached the black bulk of the house. What shall we give them? Hark the herald? No, Jack said. Good King Wenceslas. I'll count 3. 1, 2, 3. And we began to sing, our voices high and seemingly distant in the snow-felted darkness round the house that was occupied by nobody we knew. We stood close together near the dark door. Good King Wenceslas last looked out on the feast of Stephen. And then a small, dry voice, like the voice of someone who has not spoken for a long time, joined our singing. A small, dry eggshell voice from the other side of the door. A small, dry voice through the keyhole. And when we stopped running, we were outside our house. The front room was lovely. Balloons floated under the hot water bottle, gulping gas. Everything was good again and shone over the town. Perhaps it was a ghost, Jim said. Perhaps it was trolls, Dan said, who was always reading. Let's go in and see if there's any jelly left, Jack said. And we did that. Always on Christmas night, there was music. An uncle played the fiddle, a cousin sang Cherry Ripe, and another uncle sang Drake's Drum. It was very warm in the little house. Auntie Hannah, who had got onto the parsnip wine, sang a song about bleeding hearts and death, and then another in which she said her heart was like a bird's nest. And then everybody laughed again, and then I went to bed. Looking through my bedroom window, out into the moonlight and the unending smoke-colored snow, I could see the lights in the windows of all the other houses on our hill and hear the music rising from them up the long, steadily falling night. I turned the gas down. I got into bed. I said some words to the close and holy darkness, and then I slept. Now as I was young and easy under the apple boughs about the lilting house and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes, and honored among wagons I was prince of the apple towns, and once below a time my lordly head the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And as I was green and carefree, famous among the barns about the happy yard, and singing as the farm was home in the sun that is young once only, time let me play and be golden in the mercy of his means. And green and golden I was huntsman and herdsman, the calves sang to my horn, the foxes on the hills barked clear and cold, and the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy streams. All the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys. It was air and playing, lovely and watery, and fire green as grass. And nightly under the simple stars, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the night jars flying with the ricks and the horses flashing into the dark. And then to awake, and the farm like a wanderer white with the dew come back, the cock on his shoulder. It was all shining, it was Adam and maiden, the sky gathered again, and the sun grew round that very day. So it must have been after the birth of the simple light in the first spinning place, the spellbound horses walking warm out of the whinnying green stable onto the fields of praise. And honored among foxes and pheasants by the gay house under the new-made clouds, and happy as the heart was long in the sun born over and over, I ran my heedless ways. My wishes raced through the house high hay, and nothing I cared at my sky-blue trades that time allows in all his tuneful turning, so few and such morning songs, before the children green and golden follow him out of grace. Nothing I cared in the lamb-white days that time would take me up to the swallow-thronged loft by the shadow of my hand in the moon that is always rising, nor that riding to sleep I should hear him fly with the high fields and wake to the farm forever fled from the childless land. Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea. Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day.
Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight, and learned too late they grieved it on its way, do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death, who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light.
This is Jack Foley, and you've been listening to my annual Dylan Thomas program. Thomas lived from 1914 to 1953. I wrote this about him, quoting from his poem, In My Craft or Sullen Art. Dylan Thomas. Sentimentality in the stories. In my craft or sullen art, exercised in the still night. But not in the poetry, playful, full of puns, full of the longing for childhood. When only the moon rages, and the lovers lie abed with all their griefs in their arms. I read him as a child in poetry and found magic in his lines. I labor by singing light, not for ambition or bread or the strut and trade of charms. Knowing nothing of the self-destructiveness and violence that drove him, but for the lovers, their arms round the griefs of the ages, and could be answered only by words, words that in the end abandoned him and left him to die. Who pay no praise or wages, nor heed my craft or art. This is Jack Foley, and you've been listening, as I mentioned, to my annual Dylan Thomas program. I hope that all of my listeners have a wonderful new year. We deserve a good year. We deserve more than that. Let's hope that our battle with the terrible virus will be won in this year, or at least that the virus will be diminished. Our fingers are crossed. Praying people are praying. We hope everything will be okay. Thanks for listening. So long, and good luck.
To hear your poems. Thank you. Gracias.
Thank you. From the clan holding on to everything they had, while others are just looking for something to hold on to. The blues came west looking for freedom land. L.A., Sacramento, and San Francisco had that big city thing. Folks rocked in Russell City. Vallejo had a scene. Richmond had a kind of smooth Chi-Town sound of thing. But if you wanted a gun, gut-wrenching, soul-taking, down-home blues. You know, the kind of blues that your mama warned you about, and the church warned you about, the kind of blues that made your hair stand on end, snatched you out of chairs, made you shout after a fool, jump up and dance, that good old makes you want to holler kind of blues. You have to come to Oakland. Oakland, 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 the blues mecca of the West Coast. Steve was as wild and sophisticated as you were.
Storytelling for social change on KPFM.
Happy ending, nice and tidy. It's a rule I learned in school. Get your money every Friday. Happy endings are the rule. So divide up those in darkness from the ones who...
This is Jennifer Stone with Stone's Throw. Now, today's show is being taped. It's late in the year, 2021. The taping is being done by our intrepid program director, Laura Privis, without whom I could not put together two peas in a pot, my precious half hour on the fourth Tuesday of every month. Yes, this is the half hour that I try to pack in all my knowledge. Anyway, this is my season dark. Yes, is the season for endings. Anyway, December is not only the holidays, holy days, jingle bells, but it's my birthday. Oh, hell's bells, I'm doing the best I can, so are we all, I guess. Ah, I reach for the poems when things are a bit muddy. I have a nice little excerpt from a poem by Eleanor Wiley. Eleanor Wiley was... very tragic poet. She died in 1928. This is Let No Charitable Hope. Now let no charitable hope confuse my mind with images. I was being human, born alone. I am being woman, hard beset. I live by squeezing from a stone the little nourishment I get. Oh, sorry. Charitable hope indeed. I think so, yes. I think hope is the only option. It's a strange thing, but we don't have any choices at a certain point. I just still think it is unfair to live so long in an age of such biblical disasters, like Revelation, you know, four horsemen of the apocalypse, plague, famine, blood, floods of epic proportions are my only choice. Is to declare optimism. Yes. I know it all, yes. Hannah Arendt wrote, wisdom is a virtue of old age, and it seems to come only to those who, when young, were neither wise nor prudent. I think she's got it, yes. I think she's got it. Anyway, Eleanor Wiley was only 43 when she died. She was a friend of Edna St. Vincent Millay's. Millay wrote a sonnet series. It's basically an epitaph for the race of man. It's a lament on our lives, the sadness mourning our fate. But she also want to acknowledge our greatness, our beauty, you know. All that music and art. Dinosaurs didn't do that. Of course, Edna Millay is remembered mostly for her aching love poems. Seems that she loved everything. She'd stretch out her arms, lying on the ground. She would say, "Oh, earth, I cannot hold thee close enough." There you go. That seems to me to be... I'd rather do it with a tree. I just go out and... I'm a tree hugger. I think she acknowledges, as we all do, that our species will be extinct, and I think we will be missed. Not. She liked to be called Vincent, my mother's favorite poet. Ferlinghetti mentioned Edna Millay. The last time I was talking to him on the air, I asked him about today's women poets, and he looked a little blank, and then he said Edna Millay, and I thought, well, obviously, he's the right age. Poets, yes. Poets living to grow old. Lawrence Ferlinghetti was quite old, and I think that made him profound. In my case, being born in 1933 is historic. And then for the rest of the 20th century, the best of times and the worst of times. The worst being Hitler's rise to power as chancellor then. One of the first things his Nazi party did was to padlock the birth control clinics. Why do I feel something like that may be happening today? The war on women, yes. Sexism goes so deep it's hard to see. We think it's just reality. The first thing on the list in all patriarchal institutions, you know, like the church with its hierarchy, first thing is to control the women. I think that the church is a wonderful model for oppression today. It's easier to see over the centuries. The holy hierarchy of power. I don't know. I guess the Pope is a little, he's kind of friendly now, but I just tried to think about the way in which human beings form religions, usually starting out, springing from love, maybe one individual saint or a couple of saints, you know. I don't think that either the prophet or Jesus Christ were enemies of women. Indeed, I think that they tried to support women, you know, keep guys from throwing this first stone. It's the bureaucracy, you know, the guys that come along and turn it into an institution. I don't want to be put in an institution. It's like all forms of slavery. You've got to control the women. Yeah, women are the basis of the whole thing because, of course, she's got the baby, but he's got the ball. She causes fear in the hearts of the powerless because she doesn't need power. She is power. Today's woman is... it's a new woman, yes, a new woman, yes, a new wave of feminism. Talking about feminist utopias, but all that passion and hope, I find it hard to watch just at the moment. My mother would say hope is the rope we hang ourselves from, but in a man's world, the wise woman becomes a subversive. You got that? She creates an alternative culture, an underground in which women can flourish. I think, of course, she does need to know a good abortionist. I knew some nurses that would help. I remember the 1950s, mostly the women I knew went to Mexico unless they were wealthy, and then they could go to pretty places. Yes, Paris, someone said. I went to Paris to take care of it. I don't know. I do think it's fun to imagine a women's world. Sometimes we put up, you know, sort of like a mock model. There's a book called The Mists of Avalon by Marion Zimmer Bradley. There's a video of that with Angelina Houston. Angelica Houston. Oh, boy. I'm adding things that I didn't know I needed. Yes. Marion Zimmer Bradley wrote this book about the old religions and how they were really what was happening when the Arthurian legend was being put together. The legends and the stories could very well have been written from a woman's point of view. Now, I think that when women dream of pagan societies, using their imaginations, looking for the goddess, they have to do some very funny, what do you call that, shape-shifting masks. They are often saying that the Virgin Mary is a manifestation of the primordial goddess. I think that she, the goddess, the mother, is the oldest sacred being. Pagan worlds, of course, were dominated by men in every time. There's never been a time that it wasn't the boys, you know, the dominant submission paradigm. It was war. War came along, and then something changed. Fortifications, yes, when fortifications came, I think that was the first sign. Walls and war. Now, I think that the soul of man, that is the soul of woman, is feminine. Mother is the first god, anyway. Now, you just look at it. Here is the old state. I'm looking here at a poem by Algernon Charles Swinburne, 1837 to 1909. Yes. He wrote a poem called Hertha. She's an ancient earth goddess. She speaks, yes. He goes on and on and on. He goes on, he never quits. In raptures, I think he got it. But anyway, I'll read you some of his lines. He writes, Hertha, yes, I am that which began. Out of me the years roll. Out of me, God and man, I am equal and whole. God changes and man and the form of them bodily. I am the soul. Before ever land was, before ever the sea, or soft hair of the grass, or fair limbs of the tree, or the flesh-colored fruit of my branches, I was, and thy soul was in me. The first life on my shores first drifted and swam. Out of me are the forces that save it or damn. Out of me, man and woman, wild beast and bird. Before God was, I am. Now, I have all notes, kind of notes here about Robert Graves, the white goddess, all kinds of good stuff. Now, that's old. In the recent decades, there's been so much material, it's a little bit exhausting, but it's the poets try to help us. But in times like these, we're having what I would call not just the pandemic. It's a pandemica, like a great big opera. It's a pandemica. Now, I think that possibly in the past there have been one or two episodes like smallpox and the Black Plague that would match what's going on today, but I am not too sure. It seems to me that we really bought it this time. We've got still the world of the warrior, little wars going on everywhere, border wars, the fighting, the guys, that's all older than Homer. And yet, forms change. This patriarchal paradigm can give way. Not in Texas, apparently. But if the Virgin Mary is the compassionate goddess that some say she is, she will protect reproductive rights. I think we should get a big mask of Mary and go stand in front of the Supreme Court with that. Roe versus Wade is no longer protection for women's reproductive rights. I remember the confirmation hearings, Judge Clarence Thomas, back in 1991. He's been on the court ever since. Think about that. Almost three decades. Think of the damage he has done in that time. He was confirmed over the testimony of Anita Hill. It was a terrible misuse of, the thing is, Joe Biden was the chairman of the committee, which has always worried me. Now, I think Joe tries the best he can, and apparently he was bullied by the Republicans, but he could have forced them to wait. They were waiting for a few votes that didn't arrive, and Barbara Boxer said it was the worst thing in her entire career that she messed up that vote. Now, I just think of Clarence. He was pretty burned, pretty scalded by that event. And then I think of all the damage he has done over and over again. And I think, what's the phrase? The damage that damaged men do. So much power they have, so little wisdom. Judge Thomas doesn't argue his cases before the court. No oral presentations. He submits his decisions in print writes it down, and, you know, he's not going to argue with a lawyer right there where people can see him and humiliate him anyway. He refuses to be criticized publicly now. I think that there's an almost documentary movie on HBO called Confirmation. I wish we could put that in the high school. So many films would help these days. We need the videos. High schools, right. It's so close to the reality. I think that the thing that they did, they didn't deal with some of the things like his wife and son and all of that. Because they didn't want to make him look like a victim. He, of course, said he was a victim of women's beliefs, you know, whatever that is. I don't think there's any way we can change that at this point. I think that the senators are so, I don't want to say paranoid, but uptight. If you expose the behavior of so many men, you know, what they say in the locker room, well, if that comes out, it would blow their cover. Aha. 40 years. The new order allows our rulers to behave despicably now. Think what has happened in those years. DJ Trump has set a new standard for vulgarity. Public disclosure of men's obscene behavior. It's apparently okay, the order of the day. The president saying, well, he's no president anymore, but, you know, the notion that he could grab pussies anytime he wanted to. I don't know if Jack Kennedy could have gotten away with that, but I do think that the rules have changed. Certainly, they changed in Germany. Overnight, women were banned from the Reichstag. They couldn't come in, right? That's it. Just plain out. Now, January 6th of 2021 left the door open for a gang of thugs. I have to admit, I was shocked. I thought it was just a play. I thought they were dressing up, you know, just to make a point. It didn't occur to me that they might be serious. I realized that there are people unwilling to learn or not just study behave themselves because it's the law. Yes. Why the Constitution was written doesn't seem to have occurred to them. Now, I know not everybody can take history courses, but there are just some little basics that, these deplorables, as Hillary Clinton called them, you know, it's just some point at which they have to be told. It's like the vaccine. We know what's good for you. On the other hand, this is America, the democracy. They have a perfect right to mess up the whole thing. I remember that my classroom, I mean, when I was in school myself, not, but back in, 1947, there was no ambiguity there. The Nazi mindset was lethal. We all knew that. On the other hand, there wasn't much talk about the finances, the money, and what the money men were doing to keep the war going and still are. I believe that the United States is the greatest manufacturer of lethal weapons on the planet. One man rule. That's what Trump was after. Now, that is still practiced in any number of states. I don't know. I think the number may be going up, up. The authoritarian wave, it's like a stain going over the nation and, not Europe, but you know, look around, you can see democracy, on the other hand, takes years and years of talk. Churchill used to say, George. Pandemica. The earthquakes, the fires, the floods. I just pray that the people who rush to the scene and manage to do things. I don't know how it's done, but it just seems to me they appear overnight. First responders are earth angels, I guess. I don't know where they came from, so many of them. I think that the rest of us should shelter in place and not cause trouble, yes. I think it's a difficult thing to admit. But I'm more than happy simply to watch HBO and watch the world go by. I'm sure that if it comes in my front door, I'll have to do something. But in the meantime, this is the golden age of television, technology. I thought the theater was dying, and boy, oh boy, was I wrong. Some people say they prefer the live actor, and of course, there's a great deal to be said for that. On the other hand, we take what we can get. And the writers and the actors and the directors of this stuff, never has there been so much talent. I like best the historical romances, series about the past, mostly about the European past. I think that the only ones that were labeled African-American were, Shaka Zulu and Roots are often mentioned as non-white dramas, but Roots was all about America, the United States. Alex Haley, he wrote this book. He wanted to portray the path that so many African-Americans had to tread just to get from, the place where they'd been fired from the plantations, and they had to go look for either sharecropping or some kind of menial labor. So many of them, most were from West Africa, but so many of them really did not know each other's cultures. They were not encouraged to get together. It's very strange to think that all those people might have been struggling just to understand each other's languages. I'm not sure. The whole idea that freedom was something in itself. I think that it looked to me like, as I say, being fired, being let go. And of course, they did not even own the little cabin or the bit of land that they lived on. Now, the size and scope of the story of those tens of thousands in the South, hundreds of thousands, I think this story is just a vast tale of terror. There is lots of stuff about survival, horrific conditions. Well, there are also some films these days about the ways in which Black Americans have survived and come to the top. I was thinking of so many of them. The list is on HBO. You can find it. I watched Harriet Tubman the other night, and it was romantic and kind of, but it was very, very accurate. The Underground Railroad and the ways in which she had to get people out of the South. It's like World War II. You drop your spies in behind the enemy lines, and then the spy finds a way out. I think there's one series on HBO titled John Adams and His Wife Abigail Coming to the White House. I should review that in depth. Of course, they had to camp out at first, but they looked around and they saw that the White House was being built by African Americans. That registered. Next time more on the absolute need for better theater on television. This has been Jennifer Stone. I'll be back the next time. Listen for me the fourth Tuesday of every month. Go easy, and if you can't go easy, go as easy as you can.
Walk in light, light 'em up, boys. There's your picture. Drop the shadows out of sight.
Greetings, friends. This is Bob Baldock, KPFA's producer of author events for the past 30 years. KPFA is about to present a Zoom event concerning my own just-published memoir about my participation in the Cuban Revolution with Fidel Castro's 26th of July movement. Written as a novel, the memoir is titled Wild Green Oranges. I'll be interviewed on January 27th at 7 p.m. by Kevin Hunziker, KPFA's development director. We'll discuss the many months some years ago when I was the only U.S. citizen who served as a combatant with Fidel's group in the Sierra Maestra. This will be the last event Ken Preston and I produce for the station, but events will continue. Warm thanks for supporting us over the years. Our final Zoom event about my own book is January 27th, 7 p.m.